My darling children! Listen! Do I need to get on my knees to beg you to submit your P-tips so we don't blow up the website the last two nights before the due date? Get them up. Load them up. If you want feedback, drop me an email and I'll give you feedback. You do not want to walk out of this class without that document. You understand?
The first year I taught the class, it was more akin to what you would get at a 101 level at, you know, a junior college maybe. I could immediately tell that there was a cognitive mismatch. They weren't interested in dead man's thoughts, you know, they were hungry for something else. And one day, I think I just was not prepared to teach. I came into class and I just had my kids take out a piece of paper and answer the question, who are you? And they wrote for 30, 40 minutes on it. And then the next day we started reading them out loud. And at the end of each one, I said, anybody have any questions? And sometimes there would be. And then, so that first year, we literally, that was the beginning of the councils.
And this ragged old rag has been there for as long as I can remember. There have been about 3,000 or 4,000 life stories told from this chair in various forms of commitment and intensity, and the stories that have come out of that chair are pretty, they have a lot to do with my gray hair.
The only thing that's going to change is your voice, if you're asking a question, really needs to be up. Understood?
This won't fulfill the assignment. I worry too much, so I'm calloused and apathetic.
I am a combination of all the mistakes I've ever made, of all the victories I've had.
I care about my friends and I sacrifice for them.
Who am I? I am the loud noise of the city, friends to the celebrities, modeling perfection, a house divided.
But my feelings change, so I change. Why not? But then why can you ask me who I am? Fuck you.
I have a beautiful family. I care about my family.
I trap myself in my thoughts. I think of my father more than I openly admit.
I live up to a certain set of ideals and try my hardest to be who I love and love who I am. I'm a girl, a Caucasian, a student, a 16-year-old, an employee, a social security number, and a birth certificate.
I'm angry. This question is unfair. I cannot pinpoint myself because I am different every day.
I'm a Christian. I'm afraid to die.
I love sports. I love people. I love relation. I love life.
I am a child of divorce, the victim of an eating disorder, and many doses of criticism.
I'm curious. I will be curious forever.
I'm afraid of the future. I'm afraid of failing. Luckily, I'm not afraid to try. Therefore, I move forward.
I am the result of my past, of what I did, and what I lived.
I will tell you that the mental illness and drug use of my family causes me nervousness, and I cannot tell you why the thoughts screaming through my brain right now are having so much trouble coming out correctly.
I know who I am, but I lack efficient language to tell you. I'm Tim, no more and no less.
I am Ben. Benjamin Truini.
Who am I? Just a young woman trying to find her way.
I am human, living, thinking, breathing, changing, growing, crying, laughing, playing, listening, waking, running, working, being. I am that, I think.
It has really evolved more into a passage, a senior passage class, almost a rite of passage it's become at this school, where kids hear about it when they're underclassmen, and then they spend, you know, sophomore, junior year trying to figure out, am I going to take this class, you know? They hear about the councils, they hear about, you know, how anxious it can be to sit in front of your class and talk about your life.
What's your interpretation of love?
Can I, like, I'm going to try to answer that question as best I can, but, like, something happened to me a couple days ago that I want to tell you about, like, that was, like, I just thought, like, this has to be love, you know? Like, my girlfriend goes to school in Georgia, and she just left a couple of days ago. I was sitting in my bed, and, like, this song came on, and it was The Counting Crows. And, like, The Counting Crows is, like, one of her all-time favorites, you know? This feeling just swept over me, like the old times, you know? Like, it was a different kind of love, you know? It was new, and it was beautiful, and it was amazing, and it felt so good. This other song came on. It was a Death Cab song, and, like, it was one of my favorite songs. And I started to think about, like, how Anne feels, like, if this song would come on, she knows it's one of my favorites, like, how she would feel, like, you know, like I felt when The Crows came on. And, like, I was just sitting in my bed, and, like, I was sitting up, and it felt like someone, like put their foot down on my stomach, and, like, I couldn't breathe, and, like, you know, I was just in agony, like, oh, like emotional agony. Like, I just was sitting there, like, writhing, like, my stomach hurt, and I just, oh, it's horrible, and I couldn't help but think, like, this is love. Like, this is what Anne feels when she misses me, when this song would come on, you know?
Ben, when I listen to your music, I can hear sorrow. Where does that come from?
I can't imagine a day without love for people or for something. Yeah. I like travel. I like meet people. I like relation. But it's hard because all the time you have to leave. All the time. And that's hard to accept.
After teaching this class for 10 years, it probably is the number one question that comes up in the councils is, you know, what is your religion and what is your spirituality?
Can I change the subject? Mm-hmm. What do you believe in?
I believe in Jesus Christ.
I don't know if I believe in God. I know I believe in a higher power. I'm exploring my options.
Can I tell you what I think about God?
Go ahead. That's exactly what I want to know.
Okay, like, when, like, in organized religion, like, God is, like, personified, you know? It's a him. Like, it's a being, you know? But you entrust him with all these powers of, like, omnipresence and foresight and, you know, just generally being the shit, you know? And, like, you can't give, like, all that power to something with human qualities, you know? It won't fit. It's not congruent with human traits, you know?
Kids adopt their parents' notion of religion, and then they reach adolescence, and as their own authentic identity begins to emerge, there's this clash, and we've all felt it, between the old religion and the experience of what it's like growing up today.
I feel like going to church my entire life and things like that has put, like, there's, like, a little voice in my head, like, that always knows, like, the right thing to do. And, like, and the question is, like, whether or not I choose to listen to it at that time.
Well, my parents are Christian, but I don't associate myself with any group of people.
When I was in fifth grade, it was, like, regular school night. I was still going to Rudolf Steiner, and we were just kind of hanging out. We were watching 24, and, like, my dad was in the kitchen, like, and all of a sudden, like, me and my sister hear, like, this huge, like, moist, just like on the ground. And like we rush in there, like, and I see like my dad like face down on the floor. He was a big guy, like over like 300 pounds. And so like just called 911. They took him out like on the stretcher. And last time I saw him was they were about to wheel him out, and like I was standing on the steps, and like he was looking around, and like, and I saw him look at me, and I just like, I was a stupid kid in fifth grade. I just looked at him, like I put my thumb up like this, and I know we saw it. Like I saw him looking at me, like, and they wheeled him out, and that was like 10:30 late at night. So I went to bed for a while, and like woke up in the middle of the night, and my mom was in her room, and she told me that my dad passed away that night.
One thing that I really strongly believe in is that your truth is the truth for you. Like, if you believe in heaven and hell, then you're gonna go to heaven or hell. Like, I believe in reincarnation, so I will be reincarnated.
I mean, it's comforting to think, like, he's in heaven smiling down or something like that. Even though I don't necessarily believe that.
I'm really conscious, Talia, of if you are a Christian or if you are a Muslim or if, you know, that my goal is when you're done with this class that you're stronger in your belief, that you're a better Christian, that you're a better Muslim, you know, for hearing these other perspectives, you know? There's no concerted effort to undermine what anybody believes. There's just a concerted effort to expose them to alternative perspectives. Now, naturally, that the possibility is there that exposure to those alternative perspectives will undermine what they believe. But if what they believe is solid, if it's rooted well, if it's been nourished and healthy and it makes sense, it's going to withstand it. At least, I think. Perspectivism in philosophy says that there can be radically different and incommensurable conceptual schemes, ways of looking at the world, worldviews, or perspectives, one of which we have consciously or unconsciously adopted as our own. What this means is that there are many possible judgments of truth or value that we may make, which implies that no one way of seeing the world can be taken as definitively true. The council process is an attempt to provide such an opportunity where, by becoming aware of other worldviews and perspectives, each of us can better critically examine our own. The council process also provides the opportunity for the development of a broader, deeper, a more comprehensive ability to experience, adopt, and ultimately understand multiple perspectives. And this brings about the greater sense of connection one can feel with others.
Because once you've connected with these 30 people and you look around and you see how different everyone is from each other and from you, you realize that it's possible to connect with anyone. And you can, like, even if it's harder to, like, go up to somebody in a different class and start talking to them, once you kind of have a foundation from this class, it's like, it makes it so much easier outside of this class.
In a lot of my classes, I always feel really alienated and like have trouble like feeling like I'm even like the same species as other people. Just like listening to them talk and being like, where are you coming from?
It's especially really cool to like hear about not just how people feel about themselves, but how they like see the world or how they view abstract ideas. You don't just learn about like people and what they've experienced in life, you really learn about like what makes them so different from you.
Like after you hear an hour of like them bearing their souls, it's not like you can be like, they're kind of annoying. It's like you know so much about them and like you like appreciate and respect their story, and it's just like you connect with them and like you're just friends or at least acquaintances, but it's just like you can't dislike them after that. You know them.
this little eyeball with the, this is Jenna Lurch's piece, a young lady who sat in the chair, and 15 seconds after she sat in the chair, she started weeping and cried the whole hour. And she kept saying, I don't know why I'm crying. You know, she had such a beautiful life, and but she had her ups and downs, but it was just this emotional outpouring that was, oh my God. This is a very special piece for me. Sai Baba, the great Indian teacher who came to the States to talk, and what a great quote, the end of education is character. You know, man, that we could find some way to bring that back into public school education. Mary gets away, and she was just a gemstone. And she goes, I'm in the middle of my whining, and she goes, Robert, I'm a self-mutilating, post-suicidal, psycho-hose beast, and I'm more optimistic than that. And I said, what? Ran over to my computer and wrote it down. This one, this is one of the oldest ones right here. What if finding the love of your life meant changing the life that you loved? You know? These are thoughts. These are such beautiful thoughts. The really core writing assignment is for each of them, they have to write about a half a page to a page in response to each counsel, something that is positive and truthful, so that when the person reads it, they get an insight into themselves. I'm gonna teach you something about yourself that I got from listening to your counsel. And then on the last day of the semester, each kid gets this big, thick document with 28 to 30 half pages or pages of these powerful messages from their classmates. And they're all anonymous, so they don't know who wrote what, and it keeps it really free.
I want to talk about opposition to your class from a parenting standpoint.
Generally, the most resistance or the most, backlash I get from parents has to do with when a parent becomes aware that their child's going to be sharing personal information having to do with them and their parenting practices and what goes on in the house and so on and so forth, which is such a minuscule part of the counsels when you... As you experience it. But from a parent's perspective, it's a threat, and, you know, sort of like almost voyeuristic, you know, why are you, you know, what's this all about? What business is this of yours? Even though I think it's a very important philosophical issue for kids to be, you know, to examine the perspectives of how people are parented, how kids are parented. My God, how else can you become a better parent?
I hated my dad for a long time because he was an asshole. Like, I don't know, he was a son of a bitch, man. He really was. And then the day after Christmas, he went to the hospital and they diagnosed him with leukemia. And that was kind of like, it was kicking the balls, man. Like, cause like, I didn't know that I wanted him to die, but I wanted him to go away, you know? Just for at least for a little while, you know? And then 6 months later, he was dead. And I couldn't believe like how I felt. Like, I was happy that he was gone because it was over, you know? I didn't have to put up with him anymore, but like, I felt guilty too, you know, like, I don't know. It took a long time for me to work that out.
Why did your parents' divorce affect you so much?
Because I didn't see it coming at all. My mom sat me down, and my dad was on a business trip, and she sat me down and was like, your dad's not coming home. Like, he's going to another woman in her family. Like, that's it. We're getting divorced. And I, like, couldn't even say anything. I just, like, ran up to my room and, like, I couldn't even cry for the first, like, 3 months.
Why were you living on your own?
Because me and my mom don't get along at all. At all. We can't be in the same room for more than an hour without arguing. And it got to the point where if I didn't move out, then something really, really bad was gonna happen.
So good.
Here's the final words.
If I could, I would give up this council to hear you all talk a little bit more. And I don't know, I hope I've given you guys something to think about.
I feel so good. I wasn't sure that I would really get out what I really wanted to say, and like I don't feel like I could have done it any better.
You directed them too, you know what I mean? It was like, they wanted to know about religion, you said, can I talk to you about God? And then it was like, it answered all the questions.
A type of communication that teachers become addicted to, where I know something, you don't know it. I stand up in front of you, typically in a lecture form, give it to you, and now we share it in common. You know, it's a one direction for the most part. The other type of communication that takes place in my class is to make something in common where, and Bohm talks about this too, where it's you and I like we are maybe right now even, where we're starting off on a topic here and we don't know where it's gonna go.
You have, being around here, you have definitely got the attention of a lot of girls. What has that been like for you?
Great. Opening
question. Yeah, I really don't care.
Year after year, semester after semester, this happens. It's not like this is an aberration, what you've been seeing. This is our youth. This is the life these are the lives they're living. This is what they go through. And we happen to have created a process that allows it to come out, and we get to see it and witness it.
I don't think there's another class here that can really make you learn about yourself. Like, you're learning about math and science and literature, but that doesn't teach you about yourself.
That's why I took this class, was to, you know, find myself.
And everyone gets unified not by, like, something that's unifying, but by self-examination.
Yeah, I think the greatest thing that I've gotten out of this class is being able to, like, talk about problems that you have and have people, like, listen and care about it.
Everyone just wants to be loved and just have people
that's true.
Show that they care for them. Because there's so many people that sit in that chair that you're like, wow, I love this person. And then they start talking, they're like, I feel like I have no friends and nobody likes me and I'm worthless, and you just want to go up through every counselor, and you're like, I just want to give you a hug.
He will, like, just take a side role in conversation if we're just doing a dialogue in the class. Like we can, you know, we're, like, and I think that's part of us being his peers, too, is, like, we have just as much to say and, like, just as much we've thought about as he does, and, like, it's not like we're on a different level at all.
You know, they're all seniors. Every year, it's just this group. It's a targeted period of human life, of human development that has unfolded to my eyes.
This is like the diving board to the rest of your life. And this class has taught me so much. And I think this is at a really pivotal time in our lives where it's like, you know, we're getting ready to take the next step. We're getting ready to leave the nest.
Like, challenge yourself in, like, in the relationships you make with other people. You don't go for, like, the easy, like, just, like, on the surface. You go, like, you go deeper and you
And you let them know, you let them know that you care about them, and then in return they'll let you know that they care about you, and you do that with like everybody.
It's a class of 30 or 35 painting on the same canvas, and what comes out at the end of the hour is a shared understanding that didn't exist before. It was in the kid's head in the chair, but through the council process, it too gets refined. Whenever you have an experience where your perspective opens or widens, it's a liberating sense of freedom.
My counselor, yeah, she proposed to me in this class. And I was like, why not? The first time I came here, I came back at home and I said, I have a crazy class. A crazy class, a crazy teacher.
I want to create the opportunity for wherever anybody's at that they can grow further, whatever direction you're going, you know? It really is an honor to enter into their worlds, and it feels good.
J-S-E-R-M, J-S-E-R-M, J-J-M-M, J-S-E-R-M, J-J-M-M, J-S-E-R-M, J-J-M-M, J-S-E-R-M,
but you're